Very good evening, students. Topic for today is micromeretics. In this session, I'm going to cover about some basic definitions related to micromeretics topic and particle size and its distribution, and particle size distribution representation in the form of graphs. So let's begin the topic. Micromeretics involves the study of the science and technology of small particles and of the order of few micrometer size. Micromeretics, it is a study related to small particles within the micrometer range. So let's get into some applications. What is the use of studying this topic? Okay, in what way that plays a major role in the manufacturing of a dosage form or in terms of its activity also. The first application would be the release and dissolution. So here, particle size and shape, it means the surface area of a particle, plays a major role in the release and dissolution. Greater the surface area, better the drug dissolution. So the next application is linked to this one. Better the dissolution, so you can expect a good absorption, and simultaneously that continues with a better drug activity. And physical stability, it's well known that smaller the particle size, better would be the stability, as we have seen in terms of coarse dispersions, that is suspensions and emulsions. It was always specified that the particle size to be maintained minimum. And not exactly minimum, if you're trying to reduce the particle size ultimately, so the Brownian movement between the particles is reduced. When we talk about emulsions, let's use the term globules. If the size of globules is completely reduced, there are chances that the Brownian movement would be stopped, and there are chances for creaming and instability. So an optimum range of particle size has to be maintained. And dose uniformity, when you consider powders and granules, it's always good to maintain a uniform size of particles that ensures good flow property. And filling and packing. When you talk about the manufacturing steps, either filling of granules into the machine, if you think of a compression machine, you can clearly understand the granules flow from hopper into the die cavity, or else filling of granules into the capsule, or anything it can be. So in that case, the flow is the major concern, and that is indirectly linked with the particle size and its uniformity. So that is the reason it's always mandatory to study complete science and technology related to the particles. Here, particle, it is defined as a smallest discrete unit. So you can express a particle in terms of its size and also in terms of its shape. So particle size is expressed in terms of radius and diameter. So these are certain definitions related to the size, which will express the size of a particle. Surface diameter, it is the diameter of a sphere having the same surface area as the particle. And volume diameter is the diameter of a sphere having the same volume as the particle. Projector diameter is the projected diameter of a sphere having same observed area as the particle. So if you notice here, you are trying to express the size of a particle relating it with some sphere. It is because the shape of particles are not usually spherical. Usually they are irregular and asymmetrical. So for such asymmetric particles, you cannot express the size in a meaningful manner. So you are trying to relate this asymmetric particle with the closest shape, that is the nearest shape, that is sphere. Considering that sphere, you are trying to express the size of asymmetric particle, relating it with a sphere having similarity in terms of diameter, in terms of volume, in terms of the surface area and also the sedimentation. This is how they have defined surface diameter, volume diameter, projected diameter and Stokes diameter. Coming to the particle shape, this image shows you the different shapes of particle. Shape is related to the geometric shape and surface regularity, that is rugosity. You can find spherical, smooth, rounded, angular, spherical, rough, irregular shapes. So these are few shapes of a particle which we come across. And we have something called quantitative shape factor. It is a numerical value expressed to describe quantitatively the shape of a irregular particle. We cannot tell the shape of a irregular particle exactly. So what we do here is we will consider a sphere which is having a minimum surface area per unit volume. So if you notice the equation for shape factor, it is the ratio of surface area and volume. So when the derivation for the shape factor, that is ratio for surface area and volume, is equals to 6, that indicates that the shape of particle is sphere. So any deviation from this 6 indicates that the particle is not spherical and it's asymmetric. The next definition is powder. Powder is a non-homogeneous collection of discrete solid particles of different sizes and shapes interdispersed with a gas phase. So here earlier we have seen what is a particle. So when all these particles of different sizes and shapes are grouped together, then it is said to be powder. And we have arithmetic mean. It is defined as the sum of particle sizes divided by number of particles. For example, we are given with some sample size of 10. It is having 10 grams of powder, which is having some x number of particles of different sizes. So what you do here is to find out the arithmetic mean, you will know down the particle sizes of each and every particle divided by number of particles. And geometric mean, it is done when working with log normal distribution curve. It is more appropriate when you compare with the arithmetic mean, and it is calculated by using this equation and normal distribution curve, log normal distribution curve, we will discuss in the further slides. And we also have harmonic mean. When specific surface per unit weight is considered, harmonic mean has to be calculated, and the equation for this is mentioned over here. Please make a note of it. Particle number. The number of particles per unit weight. In a given weight of a sample, we are trying to express the number of particles in terms of volume, number, mean, diameter, d with a subscript vn. So this mathematical derivation is done assuming the given particles are spherical in shape. So here you can find out the mass of single particle is equals to volume into density. The same expression we know, right? Density is equals to weight by volume. The same expression is represented over here. And the next one is interconversion of distribution data. So here in the tabular column, you can see raw data given to us where the mean size and number of particles in each size, and further things I'll explain you. See, here you are trying to convert the number distribution into weight distribution. So when you are trying to understand the given data, you have to represent it in both ways, that is weight distribution curve and number distribution curve. It is equally important because when you consider two batches of a product, you have to ensure that the number of particles present in the previous batch is equal to the next batch. In terms of weight, it has to match, and also in terms of number, it has to match. So when you try to correlate these two things, and when you assure that there is no batch to batch variation, then it ensures that it is stable in terms of physical, chemical and therapeutic concepts. Okay, so to ensure that, you have to maintain the equivalence in terms of particle number and the particle weight of the sample. So here, when a data is given to us, if it is represented only in terms of number of particles, you have to convert it into weight. So from this tabular column, it is clear using this equation, weight of powder is equals to volume of powder into density. So volume represents the total of number of particles into average volume of a particle. So it can be simplified as weight of powder is directly proportional to number of particles in each size into the cube of mean size, that is D3, n into D cube. Sorry. So in the tabular column 1, in the column 1, it is mentioned regarding the mean size, and the next column is about the number of particles. The third column is multiplication of n into D and n into D square, and the next one is n into D cube. The last one is percentage weight. Here percent weight undersize. Here for the fifth column, you are taking a summation of all these things and finding out the percentage for individual size. Is it clear regarding the conversion of number data into weight data? When distribution data is given in terms of numbers, you have to convert using this formula into weight. So this is a data which shows us the number and weight distribution values for a given sample, which is estimated by microscopic method. So please make a note of these values. I mean the tabular column, where in the first column it's mentioned the size range, and the second one is about mean size range, and the third column is number of particles in each size, and the fourth is percentage frequency number of particles, and the fifth column is percentage frequency weight distribution. So if we recall the previous slide, there was a formula to convert the number of particles into weight. So this is how the third column is converted into the values given in the fifth column. So using this data, we will try to represent the distribution curve graphically. Coming to the distribution curves. So the given sample of powders, let us take two powder samples. With they may have similarity in their mean size, but they may vary in the distribution of sizes above and below the mean. Such variation can be understood only when we present the given data in the form of frequency curves. So let's start with the first curve, that is frequency distribution curve. So here the number or weight of particles lying within a particular size range, within a given range of size, the number or the weight of particles is plotted against the mean particle size, particle size on the x-axis, and the number of weight, that is the frequency, on the y-axis. So usually you get a bell-shaped curve which represents that there is a symmetrical nature around the mean. Here you can find three positive on one side and three negative on the other side. That's why you have got a bell-shaped curve. There is no asymmetric nature between the particles. The distribution of particles around the mean is symmetric. It means it's even on both the sides. There is no deviation from the positive and negative sides. And the large particles which are obtained by granulation can be described by using the normal distribution curve. So this slide represents a normal distribution curve for the data specified in the previous slide. Okay, you can go through the data given in the previous slide. Here on the x-axis the particle size is taken and on the y-axis percent frequency is taken. So here I cannot tell it is a symmetric curve. It is asymmetric or skewed curve. The normal distribution curve is termed as asymmetric. That means here the distribution of particles is asymmetric or it is skewed. Means you cannot find any evenness around the mean. The slide which I have shown just before this was a bell-shaped curve where it was even on both the sides of the mean. The standard deviation can be easy there. And here the distribution of particles is uneven around the mean. So if the frequency curve is elongated towards higher size range, then the pattern is known as positive skewness. And if the frequency curve is elongated towards lower size range, then the pattern is said to be negative skewness. So the next type of curve is log normal distribution curve. The previous curve which we have seen for the given data was completely skewed. That means in a pharmaceutical mixture we will have powders of different sizes, so we cannot expect a bell-shaped normal distribution curve. We usually get a normal distribution curve which is either having a positive skewness or a negative skewness. So this log normal distribution curve, it is plotted by taking log particle size on x-axis and percent frequency on the y-axis. Please consider the data which you have taken for the previous graph. The same data you are trying to plot in on a logarithmic graph. Just convert the given values into log particle size and percent frequency on y-axis. The advantage with this curve is, if you have noticed, the distribution pattern is made little symmetrical when compared to normal distribution curve which is given in the previous slide. There it was completely squared, whereas here it is slightly converted to a symmetrical pattern. And usually powders which are obtained by crystallization and milling methods, they exhibit log normal distribution pattern. This is the size distribution data which we will use. This data will be used to design the next type of distribution curve. Please make a note of this data. So here is the curve for the given data in the previous slide, that is cumulative frequency distribution curve. Here it is plotted by taking particle size on the x-axis and cumulative percentage frequency under size on y-axis. The given data will yield a sigmoid curve with, that means you can find out the particle size at its greatest slope. The advantage of this kind of plot is that you can determine the percentage within any size range without any difficulty. And the only problem with this kind of plot is you cannot find out the scattering of points. And if you notice all these three distribution curves, I have shown you the plots having two curves, that is number distribution and weight distribution based on the data available there. If only number distribution data is given, you can convert into weight, and if only weight is given, you can convert it into number based on the conversion table given in the starting slides. So it is always important for us to develop both distribution curves in terms of number and also in terms of weight. Given sample should be evaluated or analyzed in terms of these two parameters. This is all about the representation of particle size distribution in terms of graphical method. In the next session, we will discuss about the methods to determine the particle size. Thank you.